Dr. Bossuyt, endoscopy is fundamental to the care of patients with IBD. Are there any new developments in respect to diagnosis and possible treatments?
Well, indeed, endoscopy is one of the cornerstones in IBD, both in Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. I think the new evolutions that are coming for endoscopy in both Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis is that we have to look into what is the exact definition of endoscopic remission. And there's a lot of work that has been done and it is ongoing for that. Since the current definitions of endoscopic remission we use at this moment are not strong enough, and the variation between the different endoscopists and readers is quite high. So we need some more objective measures for endoscopic remission. I think that's the main purpose of the research in endoscopy in IBD for the moment.
You just presented data on the early mucosa healing in patients with severe ulcerative colitis. What were the objectives and main findings of the real-life BE-SMART study?
Well, what we did was looking at how people who had ulcerative colitis and received golimumab, how they did over a mid and a long term. And there we saw that early mucosal healing, being mucosal healing at week 12 or 14, is one of the main predictors on the long term. So it seems important, certainly nowadays in times of treat to target, that if we take the target of mucosal healing, and if we have early mucosal healing, that this is really one of the cornerstones also for the further treatment of the patient. So we should strive for early and deep mucosal healing to have optimal results over time.
Is mucosal healing accepted as a target in the field of IBD?
Yeah, indeed. It's for the moment there are some guidelines or recommendations, like the STRIDE recommendation from Professor Perrin-Birollet. So they say that indeed it's at the one hand it's endoscopic remission we are striving for, and on the other hand it's symptomatic remissions. It's a combination of two items that is important for defining remission and being the target currently in Crohn's disease and in ulcerative colitis.
What are the specific and characteristics of golimumab as opposed to other TNF-α inhibitors?
Well, for the moment with golimumab we see that it's not that often used, certainly as we saw it in Belgium. But I think we have to define a subgroup of patients that are optimal to use golimumab in. As we saw in our cohort, which we presented here, it's mainly for patients with rather moderate ulcerative colitis. And one of the key elements in the study we did is that if we use it, golimumab, then it's important that we do early evaluation of those patients. And that's not only the case indeed for golimumab, but it's for every treatment we do. An early evaluation of the treatment effect is important to have optimal results on a longer term.
In relation to mucosal healing, are there other treatment options that can create that effect aside from biologicals?
Yeah, I think all the current treatments we have for Crohn's disease and for ulcerative colitis have the potential of mucosal healing. But one is more potent than the other, it seems. But currently there are no head-to-head studies that can say that one is better than the other. So at this moment, every treatment can give mucosal healing over time. But we have to look in that deeper, and certainly we need head-to-head studies to see whether one treatment is better in a subpopulation of the patients to have to achieve mucosal healing.
The direct and indirect burden of patients with severe ulcerative colitis and also with Crohn's disease are very high. Are there any, what non-medical programs do exist to ameliorate the patient's quality of life?
Well, that's a good question. Currently, there are, I think the most important is, apart from just the medical treatment, is also patient empowerment. I think if the patient had a good insight in how his disease goes over time, and certainly if the patient also knows what the target is for his treatment over time, then I think it's already one important thing. And it's important to take time, certainly at the beginning of the disease course, to explain that very well to the patient and to take your patient together with you on the trip for his treatment over time.
Do you think that telemedicine can help the patients to comply to the treatment and
Well, I think there's indeed a potential for telemedicine, but it's not clear at this moment which type of patient is open for telemedicine. And it's certainly important to follow up the patient in a correct way if there is active disease. But the problem is that sometimes patients who have a complete remission, certainly for a long time, that those patients are not really interested anymore in a continuous follow-up. And they feel sometimes annoyed by the so-called e-health tools they have. So we have to find a way between which patient is open for e-health tools and which patient is not. It's not for everybody, I think.
Okay, Dr. Bossuyt, thank you very much for the talk. Thank you.
You're welcome.